Junkies!
Mum.
Yay!
So we're reviewing Babyteeth, which is a new movie that's come out, directed by Shannon Murphy.
Okay.
It's her first film.
I take it she's Australian.
From a screenplay by Rita Kalnejais, and it's based upon a stage play. So Babyteeth is a film starring Eliza Scanlen, Essie Davis, who is, we've discovered from Babadook, and Ben Mendelsohn, most significantly, but also stars Toby Wallace, who I think is a bit of a newcomer. You would describe as a sort of loser, stealing, druggy type, both a drug dealer and a drug taker. I'm a big advocate and fan of Australian cinema. It's an Australian film.
Yeah.
Animal Kingdom is a good example. And I think one of the films we saw more recently that also interestingly starred Essie Davis was The True History of the Kelly Gang.
Which, again, was Australian.
And I sometimes I wonder whether the style and sort of feel and atmosphere of these films is well, I mean, as with any cultural cinema, is dictated by the amount of space and a hot, hallucinogenic feel to it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's always a sort of strangely dislocated sense of things.
Yeah.
Parked within a very familiar world of sort of suburbia and English-speaking people and all that. So I think for me as a Brit, I always find Australian cinema quite intriguing. So as we sort of sat down and got going with this, what would you say? So the premise is what?
It starts with a bang straight away in the sense that
on a station platform.
Yeah, we're behind the main girl,
Milla,
the main girl's head, and it's all shot brilliantly, and sort of we're very close to her, and it becomes obvious very quickly that she's thinking of throwing herself under
the train. So she's a troubled character.
She's a troubled character. And then sort of we're totally into that moment, thinking this can't be happening or what will happen, when suddenly from left field, literally, comes this person, we don't even know what he is, who knocks her backwards. And then from that develops a relationship between, he's the boy, the troubled sort of drug-taking
Moses.
And there develops a very, 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 on her part, intense relationship.
Yeah. And it was a really curious opening scene. It's a very dramatic opening scene because it sort of, you know, had those quintessential things where she's looking close up, there's a train coming, you feel there's a sense of a sort of suicidal tendency there.
Yeah.
And at this point, of course, we have no idea what her backstory
is.
So we're just seeing a young girl feeling bleak, feeling isolated from the other kids in her school on the platform.
Yeah.
And then she's kind of like, you're right, she's sort of pulled back from the edge of throwing herself over by the sort of high antics of Moses rushing in and being silly.
Yeah, like that's the way they must have choreographed it.
And I'd have thought in anyone else's, I thought that scene was handled really well because in microcosm in that scene, you kind of get the whole film, which is she ends up falling into his arms because she has a nosebleed.
But then to absolutely, as a sort of end to that scene, which is a complete scene.
Yeah.
And again, actually, it makes sense it was on the stage. After all of that and her clearly being sort of quite wowed by him and being troubled and him being troubled, he says, have you got some money?
Yeah.
And in a sense, it plays from there, doesn't it? It plays from
I thought he was a fascinating character. And so what happens is the course of this film is really Milla, played by Eliza Scanlen, who we know from things like Sharp Objects.
I thought it was brilliant.
Yeah, she was brilliant. And I've been waiting for her to kind of, you know, hit the big time with a sort of with a starring part. But it's about, it is effectively, I mean, I use the phrase whilst we're watching it, this is a bit like that movie, Meet Earl and the Dying Girl.
Yeah.
But this is like the dark, realist, seedy underbelly of a story like that.
Yeah.
Insofar as Eliza is obviously, we discover, dying or suffering from cancer and is on medication and she doesn't have hair, wears wigs. And Moses becomes, is originally interested in her for her money and essentially when she takes him home to meet her family, father played by Ben Mendelsohn, mother played by Essie, they then become as a family a source of drugs.
Mm.
Because we have established that Eliza Scanlon's parents are essentially, he's a psychiatrist.
Yeah.
And the mum is what? She's a sort of musician, is she? Or she suffers from depression and takes a lot of drugs.
She does, yeah.
Did you relate to that?
Well, yeah, in the sense that most of them were sort of Valium type things. They were sort of things to dent, you know, to
take the edge off things. Uppers and downers, that classic sort of uppers and downers. Did you feel there was a sort of malevolent control from Ben Mendelsohn of his wife?
No.
Through drugs? Because at times, there was a moment later in the film where that sort of suggested. I felt... The thing with Ben Mendelsohn as an actor, I love him. He can be really hit and miss.
He can be. Really.
When he's a hit, I think there's no one better than him.
No, I don't. But I didn't think he became a hit until halfway through that.
Right.
Film.
Oh, that's interesting.
But also, don't forget, the reason I'm saying no, I don't think he's exerting undue pressure. Yeah. Is they have that sort of sex scene, don't they, quite
yes.
early on?
Yes.
Very early on.
Well, that's the second scene, I think.
Yeah, second scene. But it doesn't seem as if she is doing the exerting, not him.
I mean, I have to say, from the get-go, from the outset,
it
does
wrong foot
you. All of the characters don't make the decisions you expect them necessarily to make.
Yeah, exactly.
They all elicit, initially, you're trying... I suppose what you're trying to do with all of the characters, and this is a real kind of compliment to the film, we as the viewer, I found myself trying to pigeonhole all of them as a type.
Yeah.
And none of them were fixed types.
One realises that you do that all the time.
Yeah.
That's what was so clever about
it. Maybe that's what the film and the original play was about, because we assume, drug dealer, drug taker, no hope, lose him. But he's very charming. He's very funny.
Yeah.
Ben Mendelsohn and his wife, again, that thing of she's obviously struggling with her mental health. And that exerts a control and a sort of, casts a shadow over the family. But at the same time, she too was funny. I mean,
struggling with the fact that he, well, we can infer from the sex scene at the beginning between him and his wife, and also
Ben
the
Mendelsohn.
Fact that he's Ben Mendelsohn, and also the fact that he's sort of very taken by the pregnant
neighbour. That was odd.
I mean, that's a strange scene where he almost falls into her arms.
What an odd scene.
He's called Henry and her dog's called Henry, which is hysterically funny.
And she's very heavily pregnant.
Yeah.
And, and you can see that he's drawn to her.
But then stops and walks away.
And so every character is really richly drawn and you are really believable, and yet they're totally unpredictable, and yet they're really sort of, you relate to them and can identify them.
Maybe, I'm just thinking about this now, having seen the whole thing, and
yeah.
it will become clear in this review as we go on, but maybe Ben Mendelsohn's core is to do with he's got to stay where he is. In that marriage, in that situation, because his daughter, beloved daughter, we know that absolutely clearly from the beginning, don't we, in everything that he does, is dying.
Mm.
I mean, what can he do except do what he's doing? His wife is unbalanced, and no matter how funny she can be, or nice, or sweet, or all of the things that she can be to us as the viewer, to him, she's a pain in the bloody neck.
Yeah, very true, very true.
And also, even
so he's
trapped. And to the viewer, actually the wife, funny in the beginning, there's a dining room scene.
It's a remarkably powerful scene, I thought.
The
dining room scene, where the mum...
The boy steps up to the plate. And
Eliza Scanlen effectively just... There's no choice here. She brings this sort of reprobate, if you like, round and tries to insist that her parents like him and accept him as a sort of potential boyfriend. She's found him at the station, basically. But in this scene, Essie, the mum, is clearly quite severely not present. She's bleeding from her teeth.
Yeah.
She's saying ridiculous things. Yeah. It's quite comedic. I mean, I found myself laughing, but with a gallows humour.
Yeah.
Not at her, because, of course... But I think it was pitched as... It was odd. I mean, there were moments in this film of great surrealism.
Mm-hmm.
Weren't there? I mean, there were sort of shots, and it uses all the way through it. I thought it worked really well, chapter headings all the way through.
Yeah, I didn't think I was going to like that at all.
Did you not?
I thought it was going to drag, because they're quite short.
Yes.
And I thought, oh no, it's play. It's,
I mean, it might be something like, I don't know, Milla decides to sing a song, or it might be something like insomnia.
Yeah. There's a point, like, for example, where they go to a party and one's called Romance One.
Yeah,
and
Part
Romance
One
two.
And Romance Part Two. Yeah.
So
we see this burgeoning love affair or relationship between Moses, the drug dealer, drug taker, and Milla.
Yeah.
And it contorts into a very clever and quite complicated situation where both the parents, Ben Mendelsohn and Essie, believe that the best thing to do for their daughter is essentially to prop up this drug taker.
Yeah.
And essentially feed him drugs.
Yes. I mean,
not putting too fine a point on it.
No, I mean, to make it clear, they sort of, both parents, with all their problems, love their daughter, and really she gives them no choice.
Yes.
She's besotted with this boy, and whatever happens, she's obviously, well, she actually says that, doesn't she, more or less? She wants him in her life. She wants him doing things like taking her to parties, doing whatever the Australian version of a prom is. What do they keep calling it?
Where he goes and
wears a suit. And he's very, very with it. So, for example, that scene, he says, well, I have to wear a suit. And she sort of says, Well, you don't have to. He says, I want to. Mm. He's very good at cutting.
What did you think
through.
Of him? What did you think I of his character?
I thought he was brilliantly written as a character.
He was.
Right from the first moment he opened his mouth.
Mm.
And then scenes like that where he completely, you're completely nonplussed by his answer.
I thought it was very bold and very brave, and you don't get this in mainstream films.
No, you don't.
You don't get the idea that you can paint a thoroughly sort of dangerous character, essentially.
Yes.
He steals, he breaks in, he takes drugs, his whole world is dangerous.
Yes.
And fraught with, you know, trauma.
Yeah, which both and, her parents know because
yeah,
they
yeah,
talk
yeah,
about
but
it.
I think in a film to have a character like that and to not be afraid to show the charm, the wit, that there was a connection, albeit, you know, the quote, the film's kind of interrogation is over how much of it was his for his drug taking, how much of it was for his love of Milla. I thought it's always very bold because I was thinking as I was watching this, I was thinking for sure Maddie and Kiki would love this. There is a quite an explicit sex scene at the beginning, which is a bit awkward, you have to get past. But what I thought was quite curiously absent from the rest of the film, which I found quite encouraging actually, though I read The Guardian's review and they pulled it up on this, there was it was devoid of a sexual component really to the two main young characters.
Yeah.
You didn't really think of them having sex. There was one scene where the parents go, do you think they're having sex? Right towards the end. And I thought, I liked that. I thought that this was about more than just sex. This was about a young girl wanting to live her life. And I thought there was a disconnectedness to Eliza Scanlon's performance, a sort of meditative daydreaminess to her. Because I guess...
And a sort of playful, almost like brother. I mean, they're almost like brother and sister. There's scenes where they sort of do things either in the pool or sort of they nothing is sexual, but they're sort of playing around with each other in the sense of doing things, cartwheels and stuff, and you know, being like puppies, really.
Well, like puppies, and like you say, like siblings. And there's a sort of playfulness to him. He sort of bounds around the boy, doesn't he? Moses sort of appearing here, there, everywhere.
Yeah.
There were some particularly standout scenes. I thought the film's use of camera work we've talked about was very interesting. It adopted at times a highly stylized and quite strictly composed sort of approach, but at the same time it had an incredibly handheld, almost documentary feel to it.
Yeah.
But also a documentary feel that would sometimes sort of then sort of spin off into, I hate to use the term because I think it's used too much, magic realism, but it would go off into a sort of abstraction, not of image, but an abstraction of rhythm, I thought.
Yeah, maybe abstraction is a better word, actually, than magic realism, because, in a way, I mean, the party scene, for example,
I thought the party scene was one of my favourite.
Yeah, and mine. And the camera wasn't at all afraid to stick on her face or stick on various things.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I mean, for instance, the party scene, you know, so you walk in, and you often in these films, I'm thinking of films like Morven Callow, where you get very sort of, you know, very stylized scenes of introspection. There was that other film about the girl who had the burns that we saw.
Eighth grade,
you have these scenes and they're great moments to kind of do a lot of interiorizing of character and all that kind of stuff. What was really clever about the scene in this film, tell us what you think, guys, is that traditionally you go into any party scene, there's a thumping soundtrack, and this film has a great soundtrack. Again, Maddie and Kiki are going to love the soundtrack of this film. But in that scene, the director, the editor, whoever, made a decision to cut the music.
Yes.
It was almost completely silent. So you could hear them whispering to each other and talking to each other. And I was explaining to my mum that in filmmaking, when you shoot crowd scenes like that, or party scenes, or club scenes, pub scenes, to record them, you usually record them mute. You know, it'll be silent, and they will lay in all the sound effects so that you can get the dialogue, so you can get clean dialogue. And this felt like, I'd like to know whether in edit they shot it with a view to put music on it, but decided that by keeping the empty sound and just them whispering, it added a sort of druggy, hazy, I mean, obviously drugs were being taken.
Yeah.
There was a sort of stroboscopic sort of light thing going on. It had all of that. But it totally wrong-footed me by just stripping music out and going for an emptiness. But there were a few moments where it used a lack of sound.
He completely pulls back on any type of sound.
A bit like that moment before an earthquake.
Yeah, exactly.
And that, didn't you find, I thought the way that worked in the film was it unsettled you. So it made you feel like incoming was a crisis.
Like, why am I feeling so tense? I don't know why.
Did you feel a sense of tension throughout?
I did, actually.
It was a very tense film.
Yeah. I mean, we are in, and I suppose they did it this incredibly well. The girl, we're totally on her side, and it's played very well. The boy is charming, despite the fact that we know he's sort of no good, in inverted commas. But we're in the position of the parents. We don't know what to do.
Yes.
And I sort of felt all the time, like as I was watching it, I don't know what to advise them and I don't know what they should do. So in that sense,
it's heartbreaking from a parental
perspective.
Yeah, there was that very powerful scene when they were trying to find their daughter. She was out with Moses, the drug taker, and they were driving around and they were having an internal argument. I thought they played their relationship really well, Ben Mendelsohn and Essie. I thought it was really believable and really rich where, you know, they would get hooked on their own issues, yet they kept losing sight of the fact that they were trying to find their daughter because she was out, she hadn't taken her meds, they were worried that she could die. And I thought, you know, they could also see in Eliza Scanlon's character the fact that she was living the best of her life, even though it was the end of her life. And if you think of all that, I was thinking in a weird way, all the different colours of her wigs and her clothes, very vibrant primary colours just to her costume design. She was like a butterfly.
Yes.
I'm almost left with an image of this very fluttering butterfly, right down to the scenes where she was with her music teacher dancing in the room to a particular track that I thought was beautiful. I know you had a problem with that scene.
Yeah.
Some of those scenes with her music teacher. But there were moments of, there was a sense of her kind of coming out of a chrysalis and her sort of opening up. And in that opening up, there's the briefness of life before it sort of is.
Yeah. I felt like, I mean, I thought this film was brilliant from beginning to end. And I would only say this, that there were one or two sequences that I thought were weaker than the others.
Right,
that's
what
as strong as I'd go. And one of them is to do with the piano teacher, is to do with the music teacher. I mean, he fits in, and I felt that, again, I felt it's interesting it being a play, because I could imagine this on the stage. It builds towards, he's almost a counsellor to the mother. He's been, she's been his pupil for years. And it builds towards him saying to her, you're a woman who, a mother who plays the piano and your daughter's got cancer. In other words, saying to her, stop all this, stop all the other stuff that you're saying. I can't play this because of this. I can't do that because of this. Just that's what you are. And in that sense, I suppose, okay, we needed that line, but he didn't really fit in, I didn't feel.
You're right. No, I think I agree with you. I mean, I think it provided for me one of the most sort of inspiring scenes of her dancing. I thought that was the most beautifully emotional scene. I thought Eliza Scanlen played it so beautifully and she was just free. And I think Essie came to the door, her mother comes to the door and she sees her. So he kind of was a gateway to some really meaningful character development.
Yeah.
But I did feel his character. I mean, you're right. One of the scenes that I thought really didn't work was there was a scene towards the end where they were celebrating her birthday, was it? Or, and all of them around the table, it felt a bit twee, it felt a bit obvious. There were many scenes where characters wouldn't say things and they'd just look at each other.
Yeah.
What about that moment where Ben Mendelsohn's in the middle of dealing with a patient and suddenly runs out the door to go and change the light bulb in the pregnant woman's
flat? I've forgotten that.
And then she dabs his head. I mean, obviously it's a prelude to him potentially being unfaithful in some capacity, but...
But that's extraordinary because he's in the middle of a diagnosis.
He's in the middle of a diagnosis. And then that's so surreal. You wouldn't look at that in a script and go and believe it. And so there are so many things, there are so many unbelievable things that the characters in this film do.
Yeah.
For example, when the drug dealer is originally caught in their house, in Milla and the family's house, stealing drugs.
Yes.
And the fact that they don't then call the police.
Yes.
And the great line that Ben Mendelsohn says, you held a prong at my, you held a meat prong at my wife.
Yeah.
There's great humour in it.
Yeah, there is.
It's sparsely written, but cleverly written.
Very cleverly.
And of course, we won't give away what happens in the end, but there's an inevitability to these films, a little bit like The Fault in the Stars, in Your Stars, and Me, Earl and the Dying Girl. We have a main character suffering with extreme cancer. So there's no kind of surprises, kind of what's coming. But the way in which it happened, I thought was...
There's not an ounce of sentimentality.
No, there wasn't. And I thought that was really good.
It is. Considering that the film has stopped... I mean, I kept sort of almost being blown away, but surprised blown away again and again, because considering it opens with what was clearly a shot of her, you know, going to end it all, we know almost immediately she's got cancer. You sort of start to think, where can this film go?
Absolutely.
But it absolutely has you, doesn't it? And, and there are all these sort of little things in it that make you stop and think, well, that's, you know, I didn't know that.
And here's a bit, a little bit of a spoiler alert here, so I'm going to give you the sort of heads up. But I you know, I'd be curious to know how anyone who watches this film reads the ending. There's a very intense scene between Moses, the boyfriend, and Miller just prior to the end of the film. And coming out of that scene, I can't work out whether there's a moment of magic realism or whether he had a direct involvement in the eventual outcome.
Yeah.
You'll understand when you see the film.
Yeah.
But I'd be curious to know, because part of me wondered whether he had done what he'd set out to do.
I think we thought differently.
Yeah,
we did
think differently.
Yeah,
in that. But you got frustrated with the end, you said, when we were in the cinema.
only in the sense that I thought it suddenly, in from the scene where they all around the dinner table and it seemed like the end of a film, to the actual end of the film, seemed like a sort of add-on in a way.
Yeah.
And to me, it was saved completely by the performance of Ben Mendelsohn on
which
the beach,
I want to talk about.
Which is in his face, his eyes, and in everything. He didn't hardly need the dialogue.
I've rarely seen the portrayal of a father's yearning angst more beautifully, and it makes me emotional thinking about it. Of he inhabited that moment so completely, and I was trying to explain to Nadia that when a man, most men cry who don't want to cry, something happens to their face where it's almost like energy and force of emotion pushes their skin forward, exactly. So their face changes shape. And he was containing himself in a way that I think is probably his greatest moment as an actor.
But in that, I've never seen him act better, ever.
Never. And it was interesting because it was a scene where he was acknowledging he was so out of control of what was happening and couldn't change the course of events.
Yeah.
And it was just an absolutely beautiful, beautiful, beautiful scene.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I can't...
And so I revised my thinking based on that. In
right,
a way,
because it was such a powerful end of the
film. Yeah, because it was such a powerful end. And I mean, I kept turning to Mark during the course of watching it, and he did to me sort of almost saying, my God, she's amazing. My God, he's amazing. Because we were constantly being surprised by just how good
At times I kept stamping, I wanted to stab myself in the leg and say, is this simply because we're loving being in the cinema? But I've been to see a couple of films now, but it was a dreamy, dislocated, ironically really real film about real emotions with a sort of acknowledgement of the inherent silliness and humour that's at the edges of being a human in these strange setups.
Exactly, exactly.
And as I said before, it completely sort of wrong-footed you on what to expect of types of characters. You know, even Essie wasn't the classic type of a depressive wife who takes lots of medication.
Not at all.
And least of all was Ben Mendelsohn, the kind of psychiatrist that I thought was going to be doing what he was doing in one scene in the middle
of
the film.
Exactly.
In summary, I would just say, it's an indie film with an indie sensibility. It will wrongfoot you. It will engage you. It will move you. It's a surprising film. It's a film in which you think you've got certain character types and then they contradict themselves. It's a film in which you'll be forced to like someone that you would really hope your daughter would not bring home. And I think that's quite challenging.
Exactly.
I mean, I want the girls to see it, and at the same time, I don't want them to fall in love with Moses' character because he's not a good egg.
No, he's not.
I thought Eliza Scanlen played it beautifully in what she said and what she didn't say. I thought there was one scene, I don't know if I remember, with a strip of light just on her face and she was looking out, and that was one whole chapter. It was exquisitely shot.
It was
exquisitely performed. Often plays don't carry well. When I saw it was a play, I don't think plays carry well to the cinema because they're too static. This is very cinematic.
Yeah.
It's very colourful.
Yeah.
It's very beautiful. And it was strangely David Lynchian, I thought, in its surreal portrayal of suburbia. When I think of him walking down the streets and the pregnant woman with the dog. And, you know, the moments are sort of real oddity.
Yeah.
And you don't see that often in films.
No, you don't. I mean, I sort of thought, I've never watched As It Happens any Australian soap operas, but I sort of thought, in my mind, I've got this idea that is how Australia is.
Well,
in terms of small streets, small areas. Everybody knows each other. I mean, the actual explanation for the woman that he does kiss, and who is very pregnant, and who at one point seems to go into labour, but then doesn't. Is her relationship to them fully explained?
No, it's not. But even that, even when he does that...
It doesn't matter.
You don't even feel like he's betrayed anyone, weirdly.
No.
It's odd. Everyone...
Because he says, I'm sorry, that's it.
Yeah. And also, you know, all these characters are going through their own tormented journeys.
Yeah.
And they all pivot around trying to almost make as good as possible Eliza Scanlon's character's life.
Yeah.
And in a weird way, all three of the characters are trying to make the end of her life as meaningful to her as possible.
Exactly.
So it was tragic and sad and funny and moving and impressive. So I would give it a whopping 100 out of 100.
Whoa.
I thought it was brilliant.
I thought it was pretty brilliant as well. I feel reluctant to give it 100 though. Why is that? I'm not sure. Just the very, very sort of thing that slightly niggled me about the end, but it didn't. No, 100. I'd give it 100 too.
But
it didn't niggle me enough,
right,
for me to give it less. I mean, I thought it was on every level: sound, cinema, performances, you know, what the film was actually about when you think of those sort of films, you know, it wrong-footed me every way. I mean, we were delighted with it, weren't we? We kept sort of saying...
Such powerful performances. Yeah.
So 100 for me too.
Wow, 100 out of 100 each.
Yeah.
There you go.
Ben Mendelsohn, you can certainly act.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, all of you. And Essie, just brilliant. And Eliza Scanlen, again, just keep watching this space, a growing actress. And the guy who plays Moses, we're going to see him in something else for sure.
Charming.
For more film and family fun, don't forget to click the subscribe button and make sure to click the bell to never miss an update.